All right, so hello everybody, welcome to quantum mechanics part one, lecture 35. We have been talking about the theory of angular momentum, and well, some of you might be wondering why it is called the theory of angular momentum. After all, it's just quantum mechanics, and we already say that the theory of quantum mechanics is a theory, so why do we want to call it angular momentum also a theory? Well, because as physics, as you do more and more physics, as things become more and more complicated, there are theories inside theories which contain more theories. So it's just an expression. Okay. All right. Now, so in the previous classes, in the last lecture, I so talked about these angular momentum operators. And worked out the commutation relations, right? And so what we find is that there are two, we have four operators, and we can take any two of those to be a complete set of commuting operators. And then it helps to express everything in terms of spherical coordinates. And there is actually a very good reason for that, which is that what does angular momentum describe? It describes rotation, right? And so we should use coordinates which are adapted to rotation, right? And spherical coordinates are rotationally invariant, right? So in spherical coordinates, what happens is we can write down our LZ operator, which is this guy, and it becomes just d by d phi. So d by d phi is simply the angle around the z axis. So this angle in the xy plane. If you have this is your sphere. Right? And then you have some point here on the sphere. Its coordinates are r, theta, phi. And so obviously r is the length of this, the radial distance. Theta is the angle from the vertical. And phi is this angle which is in the xy plane. Okay, so you can call this x, you can call this y, like this. So the LZ operator just becomes d by d phi. But by the same reasoning, you can also immediately see one thing, that if you were to write the LY operator, you could take this the projection of this vector on the xz axis, right? So instead of projecting it on the xy plane, you could project it on the xz plane like this, right? And so, and then you would have your theta angle would be your deviation from the y axis, and your phi angle, your azimuthal angle, would be the angle in the xz plane, right? Let me call it phi prime, right? And so if you had such a set of coordinates, what would Ly be? Ly would be just d by d phi prime. Right, and similarly Lx measures rotations in the yz plane by exactly the same reason. And so what are the eigenstates of Lz? They are just the exponentials. So this represents something which is oscillating, right? And at a fixed radius, but we require that the wave function, the state should be single value. So that tells us that this m must belong to the integers. So the eigenvalue of Lz is quantized, right? So if you look at the full L square operator in polar coordinate, it takes this form, okay? And it is related to the Laplacian, which is Laplacian is the basically the kinetic energy operator, right? Because p hat square by 2m is equal to minus h bar square by 2m del square, right? So this is just the kinetic energy operator, and this Laplacian in spherical coordinates, it has a radial component and an angular component, and this angular component is precisely this L square operator, right? So this measures the rotational energy and this measures the radial kinetic energy, okay? So if you have a particle, if you are describing a system which is moving on a sphere of fixed radius, right, so that r does not change, what would be the Hamiltonian for such a system? The Hamiltonian for such a system would just be L square by 2i, right? Where L is the angular momentum and I is the moment of inertia, right? This would be the classical Hamiltonian. So here we get, it would be this part. So what we want to find is we want to find eigenstates and eigenfunctions of this L square. Okay, and so we will write them. Now there are two operators, L square and Lz. So they will have, we will denote the eigenvalues of L square by small letter L and the eigenvalues of Lz with small letter m. So our states will be labeled by these two eigenvalues, right? So we will put these two eigenvalues as a label on each of these states. And these states will be functions of theta and phi. Now, it turns out that when you work things out, the eigenvalue of L square, it is more convenient to write it in this form, L times L plus 1. So we still just write L as the label of the state, but the actual eigenvalue of L square is L times L plus 1. And YLM is actually some function of theta and phi, and there is some normalization coefficient, which I didn't mention. And to be more accurate, it's not a function of theta, it's a function of cosine theta. So PL cosine theta, and these are known as Legendre polynomials. And L will turn out to have integer values, non-negative integers, and M will turn out to have values which go from minus L to plus L. And how many such values are there? You can count them. There are 2L plus 1 such values, okay? Then we look at the algebraic approach, right? So what is the algebraic approach? It's similar to what we did in the harmonic oscillator case, right? So we define creation and annihilation operators there. Here also we define these ladder operators as Lx plus minus Ily. And the commutator of these operators. So it's easy enough to calculate, we can do that. So L plus minus is equal to L plus this. So what is the commutator of Lz with L plus minus? The commutator of Lz with Lx plus minus Il, right? And what is the commutator? So this will be equal to the commutator of LZ with LX plus minus I commutator of LZ with LY, right? And what is LZ commutator of LZ with LX? Well, this is equal to I LY, right? And LZ with LY, I'll first write this, LZ with LY is equal to minus I LA.
So edge cut?
Huh? Sorry?
Edge cut should be there, no?
H bar. No, I don't think there is an H bar here. No, there is no H bar here. Yeah, here also there should be no H bar. My bad. Okay. And the reason for that, okay, well, no, maybe there should be one. Okay, you're right. No, there should be an H-bar. Yeah. So this becomes H-bar, and then you will get I square will be minus 1, so this minus will go away. You'll get plus minus LX plus ILY. And so that can be written as plus minus IH bar LX plus minus ILY. Right, so I've taken the plus minus out. And what are we left with here? This is L plus minus. So the commutator of LZ with L plus minus is equal to plus minus H bar L plus minus. So this is exactly like the situation that we had with the harmonic oscillator, where we had this number operator, A dagger A, and the commutator of this with the annihilation and creation operators was like this, right? So if you write A dagger as A plus and A as A minus, then you can write this A plus A minus, commutator A plus minus is equal to plus minus A plus minus, right? So this has the same form as this expression. So what this tells us now is that, let's say that you have an eigenstate of LZ. So LZ YLM theta phi is equal to M times H bar YLM theta phi, right? And we act on, so we take YLM theta phi and put it on both sides, right? What will we find? We find LZ L plus minus acting on YLM, is equal to plus minus H bar L plus minus acting on YLM. Okay. Now LZ acting on YLM, this guy, is equal to H bar times M times YLM. Okay. And what you can do now, so you can write it like this, LZ times L plus minus YLM is equal to H bar M plus 1, M plus minus 1 times L plus minus YLM. So I've taken this over to the right hand side of my expression, right? So what does this tell me? This tells me that if I write L plus acting on YLM, and this is some state phi, okay? then LZ acting on phi is equal to H, and I'll call that phi plus minus, is equal to H M plus minus 1 phi, right? So this phi is an eigenstate of LZ. It's an eigenstate of LZ with eigenvalue M, which is one unit more M plus or minus 1 than what you started with, right? So if you think about, again, you think about there being a ladder, and this is the state M, M plus 1, M minus 1, M plus 2, M minus 2. And then if you act on this state with L plus, it will take you up here. If you act again with L plus, it will take you one more. If you act with L minus, you'll go down the ladder, right? I hope that this is clear, and I hope that it makes sense, okay? What happens with L square? Well, let's look at the commutator of L square with L plus minus. This is very easy to calculate now. What is this? This is zero, right? Because we know that L square commutes with Lx and Ly and Lz, right? So this tells me that L square will have no effect, right? L plus minus will have no effect on the eigenvalue of L square, right? L plus minus will not change the L value, right? So L plus minus YLM gives you Y of L M plus minus 1, okay? It doesn't change L, it only changes M. All right. Now, now let's say that let's write the eigenvalue of L square. Okay, let me write it as lambda. Let's say I don't know that lambda is actually equal to L times L plus 1, right? So I'll just call it lambda. And the eigenvalue of LZ is equal to and it'll be h bar squared, h bar m YLM. Now, if you look at this operator, it's equal to Lx squared plus Ly squared, right, plus Lz squared. And this is a Hermitian operator. Okay, this is a Hermitian operator because each one of these other operators, Lx, Ly, and Lz, they are all Hermitian. So the square of these operators is also Hermitian. Okay, so this is also Hermitian. In addition, it's a positive operator. Positive because its eigenvalues are all positive, right? So if you say that L so it has positive eigenvalues, right? And the eigenvalue of Lz, what is the eigenvalue of Lz? It's m, right? So Lz square will go like m square. Right? So if you act on some state, if you act on some state psi, right? So this state will be a eigenstate of both L square and Lz, right? That's how we have chosen our convention to be, right? So this will be M square. And then this will be, this will also be an eigen, this will also give me some eigenstate, eigenvalue of, let me write that as mu square psi, right? So this whole thing is equal to lambda times psi. So what is lambda? Lambda is equal to mu square plus m square, right? So which tells me that lambda is always greater than or equal to m square, right? Now, what does this imply? This implies that let's say I start off with y l m, some m, okay? Let's say I start off with y l 0. And then I act on this with l plus. I'll get y l 1. I act on this with l plus again, I get y l 2. Right? And I keep acting l times until I get y l l. Right? Now, if I was to act on it one more time, what would I get? I get y l l plus 1, right? But l plus 1, which is m, right, which is the m value for this state, right, will not satisfy this inequality. Right? So if you say L plus 1 is equal to M and you take the square of this, so M square is equal to L square plus 1 plus 2L, this is greater than L times L plus 1, right? Which is what this lambda is, right? You can compare the terms on both sides and this is larger. And so this is not allowed, right? Similarly, if you start with YL 0 and you apply L minus, you'll get YL minus 1, YL minus 2, until you get to YL minus L, then Y minus L minus 1, right? But again, here we have m square, remember, and here m is minus l minus 1. So m square is equal to l plus 1 square is greater than l plus, which is not allowed. Right? So in the harmonic oscillator case, if you remember, if you acted on with a dagger, with n, right, you get some root of n factorial times n, something like this, right? And there is no limit on n. There is no upper limit on n, right? N can be any non-negative integer. You can start from zero and you can go on infinite, right? But here there is a limit, right? What is the limit? You have m max. What is m max? M max is equal to L. And what is M min? It's equal to minus L. Right? Because once again, just see this. What does the action of L plus minus do? It changes the M value by plus or minus 1. So if I act on YLM, starting from YL0, if I act L times, I will end up with YLL. And if I start with L minus, YL0 and act with L minus L times, I will end up with YL minus L. And so N can take all of those values between minus L and plus L, including 0, right? So M, what are the possible values? Minus L plus 1, minus L plus 2, right? Up till 0, minus 1, 0, 1, so on, L minus 1, L. How many such values are there? The positive values, there are L values. The negative values, there are L values. And there is 1, 0. So the total number of values, right, is 2L plus 1. Right? So there are 2L plus 1 states with different values of M for each fixed value of L. Now, if you go back to this thing, atomic orbitals, right? What have you learned in, in earlier years? That atomic orbitals are labeled like this, right? 1s, 2s, 2p, 3p, 3d, and so on, right? And so 1 is what? 1, this is the n, this is the principal quantum number, right? This comes from the radial part of the Laplacian, the radial part of the kinetic energy. Well, it comes from a combination of the radial and angular part, both of them. What about S and P? S and P, these correspond to the different L values. So this is L is equal to 0, this is L is equal to 1. Right? L is equal to 0, 1, and 2. Like that. Right? And then for each one of these states, for let's say the 3s state, right? So for 3s, what are the M values? M, there is only one value, right? 0. L is equal to 0. So M is equal to 0. That's it. For 3P, let's say, L is equal to 1. What are the allowed values of M? Minus 1, 0, and plus 1. Right? And similarly for the d orbital, you'll have minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, and 2, like that. Okay? And then we will see that all of these have a very nice physical, visual interpretation. Okay? And what else? So, any questions at this point? No questions? Okay. Now, there is one thing that remains to be understood. Well, there are many things, but this is one of those many things which we have not yet figured out, which is that when we act on this YLM right. So if you remember for the harmonic oscillator, if you act on with a dagger, what do you get? You get root n plus 1. And what is this? This is a normalization coefficient, right? So, and how do you obtain this? Well, you take this guy and you take the inner product of this guy with itself, right? So this is some state psi. This is the Hermitian conjugate of that state psi, right? So when I take the Hermitian conjugate of A dagger, I'll get A. And then you apply the commutation relation to write A dagger A. So what will you get? You will get N. So you have A dagger is equal to 1. So A dagger is equal to A dagger A plus 1, like this, right? And now you can calculate this. This is equal to N plus 1, right? So the norm of this state, the norm of this state is N plus 1. So this coefficient should be equal to root of N plus 1. Right? Why? Because the norm of all of these eigenstates are normalized. Right? So if I take the norm of the left and right hand side, they should be the same. If I take the norm of the left side, what do I get? I get N plus 1. If I take the norm of the right side, I get the norm of N plus 1 times N plus 1. So they are this. So similarly in this case, right, we have these YLM, okay? And I'll write it like this now. And these are normalized, okay? And so if you act on, and so by the way, when I'm writing it like this, YLM, when I'm writing it like this, remember that right now, this is not, the dependence on theta and phi is not given. Okay? This is just a state labeled by its eigenvalues. But if I write it in the position representation, then I would write it like this. YLM theta phi ket theta ket phi, and then what is it? Sine square is sine square is it sine theta? Sine theta d theta like this. So this would be the coefficient of the expansion of this vector in the position coordinate, in the position, angular position basis. Right? So these are the position eigenket, the theta eigenket and the phi eigenket. Okay. So now L plus minus acting on YLM is equal to some coefficient, right? We don't know what that coefficient is. Let's write that as C plus minus acting on Y multiplied by this coefficient, right? And so once again, we can take the inner product of this, right? So we take the inner product of this. So if I write L plus YLM is some state phi, right? Then I want to find what is the Hermitian conjugate of this phi. So the Hermitian conjugate will be YLM times L plus Hermitian conjugate. Now L plus is equal to LX plus IY LY. So L plus Hermitian conjugate is LX Hermitian conjugate minus I Ly, Hermitian conjugate. And since all of these operators are Hermitian, this becomes Lx minus I Ly is equal to L minus. Okay. So if I take the norm of both sides, phi phi, right, what do I get? I get YLM, L plus Hermitian conjugate. So L plus Hermitian conjugate is what? It's L minus times L plus YLM is equal to this thing, P plus squared, and then norm of YL M plus minus 1, M plus 1, YL M plus 1. And now you can just put a minus plus in all of these, and that will cover the other case also. Right? Because one is the Hermitian conjugate of the other. Right, so we have M L plus minus or L minus plus. Now, what is M L plus minus? Really, we can work that out. This is equal to L X plus I L Y times L X minus I L Y, which is equal to L X squared plus L Y squared. Minus I times the commutator of Lx and Ly. Right, you will get two terms. One term will be Lx Ly, other term will be minus Ly Lx. So I can write down the commutator. Right, so this commutator is what? This is equal to I H bar Lz. Okay, and what is this Lx square plus Ly square? This is equal to L square minus Lz square. So this quantity becomes L square minus Lz square, and then I have an I cancels and I get a plus H bar Lz. Right. That's what this L plus minus is. Now I can take this L plus minus and act on YLM. L plus times L minus acting on YLM equal to L square minus LZ square acting on YLM. What will this give me? L square acting on YLM will give me H bar square L times L plus 1. LZ square acting on YLM will give me H bar square M square. And then this will give me H bar square M YLM. I get H bar square because I already have a factor of H bar stand sitting out here. And then LZ will give me one more factor of H bar. So this is equal to H bar squared into L L plus 1 minus M squared plus M Y. Okay. And we can put a minus plus here also. That will only affect this last term. I will get plus minus M over here. Right? So what is this C plus minus squared? The C plus minus squared will be the square root of this quantity. So this implies that C plus minus is equal to H bar into root of L into L plus 1 minus N square minus 1. And sorry, plus minus 1. And this expression is normally, you can write this as L times L plus 1 minus M into M plus minus 1. Like this. So finally, we get that L plus minus acting on YLM is equal to H bar square root of L, L plus 1 minus M, L plus minus 1. Okay, and we can put a box around that. Now, this expression, the normalization, it can also, so if we expand it out, it's L squared plus L minus M squared plus minus M. We can also write it as follows. We can take these two terms, L squared and minus L squared, common. So we get L squared minus L N squared. This becomes L plus M into L minus M plus L plus minus M, right? So you can take this factor common. You can take L plus minus M common, right? So if you take L plus M to be common, you'll be left with L minus M plus 1. If you take L minus M to be common, you'll be left with L plus 1. L plus M. Okay. So this is another way in which this expression is sometimes written. So C plus minus can be written as H bar square root of L plus minus M, L minus plus M. Okay. And I think that is also box worthy. Okay. So this is the theory of angular momentum of a single particle. Okay. Of course, there is much more that can be said, and we will talk about that. For instance, what is the form of the YLM functions? This YLM theta phi, right? I said it's some normalization times PL cosine theta times e to the I m phi, right? So how do we get this expression? You get this expression from solving from Laplace's equation. What was Laplace's equation? Laplace's equation is del square f is equal to lambda f. This is Laplace's equation, right? And in terms of quantum mechanics, what is this? This is the kinetic energy. So this is basically you are solving for the eigenvalues of the kinetic energy. And if you write del square in terms of, you can write del square as a radial part, right? There's a radial part and an angular part, right? So I can write it as 1 by r square d by dr r squared d by dr, and then plus 1 by r squared, 1 by sine theta d by d theta, sine theta d by d theta, 1 by sine squared theta d phi squared, like this, right? This is del squared. And this derivative, this part depends only on r, this part depends only on theta, this part depends only on phi. So we can, once again, we want to solve this differential equation. So let us assume that f can be written as using separation of variables in this manner, right? So if you apply separation of, if you apply act on this function with this guy, right, what will you get? You'll get this operator, right? 1 by r squared. So again, what was the prescription, do you remember, for separation of variables? You take f, you act on it with this operator, and then you divide by f, right? That's equal to lambda, right? So when we act with this del square on f and we divide by f, what will happen? This part will only act on the radial part, and these two terms will come out, right? So when I divide by f, I'll be left with this, right, from the first term, and then from the second term, 1 by r squared, 1 by sine theta times this theta function d by d theta, sine theta d by d theta, theta function, right? Plus 1 by sine square theta times the phi function d square d phi square times the phi function, right? And this is equal to some lambda. Now here you might say, well, that I have a dependence on r square in this term. So what do? I multiply everything by r square. If I multiply everything by r square, I get 1 by r, right? And then I'll get lambda times r square. So I can bring that over here. I can write minus lambda r square. Now this is only a function of r, right? Only depends on r. There is no dependence on theta and phi. This is purely a function of r. What about the other two terms? Well, I multiplied everything by small r squared, so this goes away. And then I'm left with this expression. Okay? That's it. And this is equal to zero. Right? So now I'm left with two differential equations. One is a differential equation for r. Okay. And one is a differential equation for theta and phi. Right? Now the sum of these two has to be equal to zero, right? So that means that if this is equal to some number, let's say plus k, then the other term has to be equal to minus k, right? And now once again, this thing, you can see there is a dependence on, there is a term here that depends on sine square theta. So what do? I again multiply everything by sine square theta. When I do that and rearrange a little bit, what do I get? I get sine theta divided by this function theta times d by d theta, sine theta d by d theta. Then plus k times sine square theta, right? Plus 1 by, now the sine square theta goes away, right? Sine square theta goes away, so what am I left with? I'm just left with 1 by phi d square phi d phi square is equal to 0. Right? So once again, I have this thing, which is solely a function of theta and solely a function of phi. Right? So once again, this has to be equal to some constant. I'll call that k prime and I'll put a square in that and I'll call this minus, this has to be equal to minus k prime square. So what is this? The phi equation becomes d square by d phi square is equal to minus k prime square, right? So what are the solutions of this? The solutions are a to the power of ei k prime x, or sorry, phi, b times e to the minus I k prime. So this k prime is the same as my m, right? It's my z angle of momentum. So my theta equation becomes what? It's my theta equation. This is equal to m k square, so I can write that as m square. Right? And so I get the following differential equation, sine theta d by d theta, sine theta d by d theta plus k sine square theta minus m square sine theta, this is equal to zero. Now this equation also doesn't look very easy to solve. So there are, but people had looked at this. One of the people who looked at this was Legendre, right? So this is known as Legendre's equation. The solution of this equation are Legendre polynomials. Okay, this equation turns out to be an equation which was studied by Bessel. It's called Bessel's equation, and there are ways to solve both all of these equations. Okay, so I'll stop here for now, and then in our next class, we'll continue this and we'll talk about the solutions of these equations. Okay. All right. So what will that give us? That will give us the solution of the hydrogen atom. And I think this is Bessel's equation. I might be wrong. Okay. I'll have to double check that. But you see, the separation of variable procedure works step by step by step, right? And now you might ask yourself, well, this looks very complicated. How did anybody find this answer? And the explanation is that, well, nobody just found this answer by magic, right? This required centuries of work. First, there was Newton who developed calculus, right? Then somebody thought that, well, let me look at this del square operator, and Laplace looked at it, right? So this became to be known as Laplace's equation. And then in different coordinates, one can write this expression. In spherical coordinates, you get this. Then somebody thought, how do I solve this? Right? Now, you could assume that, well, this is some function of r theta phi. But if you start with some with this assumption, then it becomes very difficult to solve. If you instead make the assumption that it's a product of these three functions, right? R of r, r theta and phi, right? Then you plug this in. You plug this into this expression. You plug it in. Then what's the next step? You divide by f again, right? So it's a process. It's not something that somebody came up with like in magic, right? Sitting there in one evening. It required lots and lots of searching and researching. And then eventually people realized, well, this is the shortest path to go from A to B. This is the shortest path, and that shortest path is what is given into you in your textbook, right? As separation of variables. But to get from A to B, people didn't take that shortest path. They didn't have that path. They went from A to C, C to D, D to E, E to F, to G, and then to B. And somebody else took another complicated path, right? So this brings us to path integral, which we'll talk about at some point if anybody is interested, which has absolutely nothing to do with what I just mentioned, but it's just a play on words. Okay. All right. So I'll stop here now and see if you have any questions. So my point of saying all of that, of telling you that whole story, is that when you're studying this and you think that, well, when you do one step and you do next step and you're like, I don't see where the next step came from. You have to remember that the next step is the result of many, many years of hard work. Each step is the result of many years of hard work by many people. So if you cannot see immediately where it comes from, don't panic, don't worry. Okay? Because it didn't come about so easily. All right. So, questions? If there are no questions, then of course you're free to leave. But otherwise, you can ask me if you have any questions, okay?
Okay, sir.
All right. Okay, bye-bye.
Bye, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yep. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.